Hello, welcome to the second series of BLA webinar entitled Library Carpentry, and this is the last and the final, that is the third session related to bibliographic relationship. Now, in the first two lectures or the first two webinars of under that particular series, we dealt with different applications of data science. And in the first webinar, we started with the basics of library carpentry, application of data science. In the second webinar, we dealt with different advanced level concept like named entity recognition and different kind of data extraction tools with the help of an open source software called OpenDefine. So this particular deliberation, this third session, deals with the visualization of bibliographic relationships. So this actually deals with the application of graph theory in library catalog. Now you know that we actually decided that in this particular webinar series of BLA, we will be dealing with different cutting edge applications related to library and information services. And I am very much thankful to Joydeep, who actually took all the pain to conduct a different webinar series under the purview of BLA, that he readily agreed with the proposal, and we started the series. So this is the last in the row lecture on visualizing bibliographic relationship and application of graph theory in library catalog. So let us start the deliberation. Now you can see that it deals with bibliographic relations. It is not a new concept to all of you, because for the LIS fraternity, bibliographic relations is a part and parcel of the broader concept related to library cataloging. But the new things here we are dealing with, that is the application of graph theory in library catalog. And in this particular deliberation, we will be discussing different theories related to library catalog over the last 200 years, right from the Panizzi to the present age, and we will be discussing different advantages related with the visualizing of bibliographic relationship, which so far not actually implemented in library catalog part anywhere in the world. So let us start the discussion, and let me start this deliberation with a certain proposition. First proposition is that a library is user centric. You know, all the five laws of library science actually supporting this particular proposition. All are things we perform inside a library to provide library and information services are mainly user centric nature. So nowadays in modern times, lot many technologies we are utilizing inside a library. So an instance of technology in a library is user centric. So my proposition that a library is technology centric is user centric, because a particular piece of technology, when we are going to utilize that one inside our different kind of library information services, maybe an improvement of the existing services, or maybe a completely new type of services. So every time we are proposing a technology oriented library services, mainly for the user. Now the question comes, what I am saying? So now if we go to again to the slide show, then you see that I am asking a few questions to all of you. So why ISBT appear? So ISBT appear, you all know that during the decade of 70s, just to take the advantages of using low cost PCs in the cataloging. Then ACR 1 was the prevailing cataloging code at that time, but ACR 1 was not quite accommodative, not quite flexible to accommodate ISBTs inside the framework of the cataloging code. So people started developing a new code which is known as ACR 2. So ACR 2 all developed actually developed to include ISBTs to support computerized cataloging. So my proposition is here, when our principles and policies are changing, that is actually technology driven. So libraries' principles and policies and theories and practices we are adapting nowadays mainly because of the technology developed in the year of 1465 by Gutenberg, that is called printing technology. So because of the printing technology, printed resources came and we started developing our policies and principles to accommodate large volume of printed resources. Now, when another revolution came, that is the availability of low cost computer, availability of the network, availability of the different kind of relational database management system, our policies and principle again started changing. So what happened in the next after ASCII developed? So ER modeling came in 1976 to take full advantages of RDBMS. RDBMS actually conceptually came in the year of 1972-1973, but to take the full advantages of RDBMS is what it can do with different kind of entities and their relationship. So we proposed a model, the computing industry proposed a model that is called ER modeling in the year 1976. So when again technological change took place, so our integrated library system started utilizing RDBMS as the backend database management system, but only for module integration, not for data modeling level. So we utilized RDBMS, but without taking care what ER data modeling can do for us. Because that particular time, with the advent of ISBDs, different versions of ISBDs and ASCII, we were not in a position to take the advantage of ER data modeling, because our bibliographic processing based on a flat data model called ISBD, different versions of ISBD. But IFLA and many practicing professionals, many library scholars felt the need of entity relationship modeling. So IFLA, right from the year 1998 to 2008, they came up with three different models, bibliographic data models based on ER modeling. So first one you all know, FRBR, functional requirements for bibliographic records. Second one is FRAD, functional requirements for authority data, and third one is related to the subject authority data. So in the year 2016, IFLA combined all these three different but related sets of authority data model, bibliographic data model, etc., into one particular model that is called library reference model in the year 2016. And we all know that IFLA and Library of Congress are competing with each other in the domain of library and information science. So meanwhile, Library of Congress also came with a model. It's a poor imitation of LRM BibFrame 1.0, and then they gradually came up with the BibFrame 2.0, just to take the full advantages of ER data modeling, the back end RDBMS we are dealing with in different library related software. Now ASCII, just the history actually repeated. ASCII actually was not quite ready to accommodate FRBR and FRAD. Actually that framework was not that flexible. So what happened? We again started developing a new cataloging code that is called RDA. And meanwhile, another important thing happened, that ILSS, that is our primary software we are utilizing inside library management, that is the integrated library system, that also started changing from ILS to LSP. And LSP came into picture because of two important things. One is the incorporation of RDA, resource description and access, the new catalog code, which is again supported by FRBR and FRAD as bibliographic backend bibliographic data model. And different other workflow integration like third party authority control, like ERMS, like e-learning workflow, etc. So present era is the era of LSP, and LSPs are basically trying to take the full advantage of entity relationship modeling and the application of relational database modeling along with the RDA, our cataloging code. So in the right hand side of your slide, you can see that in fact, RDA proposed that there are only three distinct elements inside a bibliographic data management system. One is the entity, Another one is the attribute, that is the different, you know, important characteristics related to an entity, and then there is relationship between entity to entity. So it's a trinity of bibliographic universe: entity, their attributes, and relationship between entities. So bibliographic relationships is actually coming up very rapidly, and visualizing bibliographic relationship inside a library catalog can generate lot many new information services in this era of technology driven library system. So next one is the what next we simply do not know, but what happened we already know. What happened, the moral of the story is that library is always technology driven. When a groundbreaking technology came into picture, we are enthusiasts to take the advantages of that ground level or the groundbreaking technological breakthrough and incorporated that inside the library system. So let me again quote from the latest model of IFLA LRM FRBR that is published in 2016, and you can see the importance of relationship nowadays in bibliographic universe. So they said that relationships are an essential part of the bibliographic universe, and they connect instances of entities and provide context for them. So that is actually give us an idea that increasing importance of bibliographic relationship, its visualization inside our library catalog. Now another interesting feature took place during the last few years, that is called we are actually moving from the library world to the glam world. Now what do we mean by GLAM? GLAM stands for an integration of galleries, libraries, archives and museums. So now the relationship, bibliographic relationship became quite complex in nature, because you can see from the slide part that in the publication domain we have article, book, brochure, clippings and etc. But there are many instances, many entities related to the galleries, related to the archives, related to the museums, and they can share lot many types of complex relationship between the entities. So let me quote from one of my favorite author, Douglas Adams, the long from the book he has written, The Long Dark Tea Time of the Soul, where he said that I rarely end up where I was intending to go, but often I end up somewhere that I needed to be. So that is the essence of bibliographic relationship. It can provide a panoramic view of the entire bibliographic universe, including the galleries, libraries, archives and museum material, cultural material, heritage material and different kind of textual material and interrelationships between them. And if we are able to visualize that kind of bibliographic relationship inside a library catalog, that will be a great help to our users in this complex dynamics of information entities. So where I got this particular idea, actually this idea is not completely new one, and that all on a sudden I got this particular idea. It has got a long history, long past. I published a paper in the that time I was in Vidyasagar University. I published a paper in the journal of Vidyasagar University, Journal of Library and Information Science. You can see that use of FRBR as a model for bibliographic description in online environment. In that particular paper, I predicted a few futuristic activities. Way back in 2002, I predicted in that particular paper that in future there will be a single point retrieval for heterogeneous resources, ISBD will be revised, cataloging codes will be revised. That time RDA was not there, that time FRBRized mark was not there, but I predicted that mark revision is due. But many things actually came true, but predicting future is always a risky business. I wrongly predicted that there will be new series of ISBDs, but that never happened. Existing ISBDs actually corrected, actually modified to suit or to accommodate FRBR. So those are now called FRBRized ISBDs. So that never happened. So that's why I have given a red mark here. But rest of the prediction I made in that particular paper is actually came true. All came true. But here I encountered the concept of bibliographic relationship proposed by Barbara Tillett in the year 2002. That time, no technological tools were there that can, assist me. So I, started discussing different kind of theories, underlying the theories, different kind of mathematical formula. But actually, the problem was that I cannot, prove that particular concept through a demonstration kind of thing. That means I cannot prepare a prototype based on that particular theories. So nowadays, because of the advent of open source software, open standard, lot many, JavaScript available free of cost as open source that can be integrated inside library system. So on the on behalf of that particular on the basis of that particular development, now it is all possible to develop such kind of a prototype that can display or support visualization of bibliographic relationship. So let us go back again to the slide mode. So, the first the concept, as I said, that I got the concept of bibliographic relationship through different publications of Barbara Tillett. Barbara Tillett, for example, in the left hand side of the slide, you can see she proposed actually that the how two different editions of a book related with each other, how an item within a series is connected with the series as part of the whole series. So, for me it was something like connecting the dots. The children at the childhood time, we all got this kind of books where we need to connect the dots, and then only the complete picture will be available. So bibliographic relationship is actually nothing but connecting the dots. Different kind of heterogeneous but related resources can be connected together to provide a panoramic view of the bibliographic universe to the users. So Barbara Tillett first proposed that in 1987. Barbara Tillett, she retired as the director of Integrated Library System of Library of Congress, and she is basically a rare variety of library scholar. Nowadays we don't see that kind of personalities, that kind of initiatives. So Barbara Tillett is a actually a role model for the entire library profession. How a working or practicing library professional came up with different kind of research activities. Her work related to authority data sets, her work related to the bibliographic relationship, integrated library system, all are commendable. She actually won the Margaret Mann Citation Award and Library of Congress Lifetime Contribution Award and many other feathers in her cap. But actually, if you see that bibliographic relationship, actually first perceived by Paniji way back in 1841, although he never used the term bibliographic relationship, but the conceptually it was there. Paniji suggested cross references to be utilized to display bibliographic relations in the 91 rules, and he divided them into three groups. So all cross references for linking different kind of related resources he proposed, and he grouped them into three groups: from name to name linking, from name to work linking, and from work to work linking. So Paniji also pointed out that the bibliographic relationship between the different editions and version, translation, etc. of the particular work. So he mentioned that there is a relationship between the different editions, different versions, translated versions of a given work. But he never used the term work. Later on, the Lubezki actually utilized the term work, but conceptually it was there. Then the next important factor, you all know the father of library cataloging, Carter. Carter actually given the three basic objectives of cataloging. I am not going into details of that. You are as a library professional, as a student of library science, as a person associated with library information science, you all know these three basic objectives. But what I want to point it out here is, in fact, if you categorize this particular two objectives, you will be getting two, you know, fundamental functions related with this objective. One is the finding function, another is the collocation function. The first objective, as proposed by the Cutter, is directly related with the finding functions of a catalog, and the second and the third objective he proposed actually related with the collocation. So, Cutter explicitly stated collocation as the objective for a library catalog, second and third objective. He designed his code to describe bibliographic relationship between items in the then prevailing form of catalog. So, here later on, you know, research shows that Cutter made two mistakes in his objective. One is that he first placed the finding function, he actually placed the finding function first and the collocation function first. Later on, Lubezki actually revised the objectives and he placed the collocation function first, then the finding function. So, another lacuna of that particular model as proposed by Cutter is that he only mentioned relationship between the items. So, he actually never differentiated between the term book and between the term work. So, in particular, in the theory of Cutter's, in RDC, work and books are actually same entities. But Panizzi actually proposed a different kind of thing. He actually proposed the concept of work, but not in the in that particular terms. But another advantage what Cutter proposed that we are all still following in printed cataloging till date, that is the different kind of linking techniques he proposed in RDC, that is notes, references, uniform titles, specification of editions, collation, etc. Collations were used to report the bibliographic relationship among items under an individual serial title. So, here one of the lacuna or problem with this particular theory as proposed by Cutter way back in 1876, that the concept of book and the concept of work are not two distinctive concepts as proposed by the in the theories of Cutter. So, later on he proved wrong actually by Lubezki. Meanwhile, in between the Cutter and Lubezki, two important things happened in the domain of library cataloging. One is ALA 1908 code and LOC 1949 code. But here you see in both the cases, ALA code proposed the collocating of related bibliographic items. It was actually, it remained one of the shaping forces for ALA cataloging rules in 1908. But Library of Congress descriptive cataloging gave us a idea which in future we carried in ACR 2 or ACR 1 in fact, that is the tracing techniques. So, in 1949 code, they proposed the concept of tracing techniques to display bibliographic relations in these rules. So, they never utilized the term bibliographic relationship, they always utilized the term collocation. But note, please note here that the relationship were still addressed at the code development level, not at the theoretical level. We did not have, until the work of Lubezki and Verona, the theories behind the bibliographic relationship. Then entered the work of Lubezki actually. So, there are actually the major contribution of Lubezki to the bibliographic relationship literature is basically twofold. First, he revised Cutter objectives, which has remained unchallenged for 75 long years. And if you read the revision, you can see that what he proposed, that to reveal to the users of the catalog under one form of the author's name, what works the library has by a given author and what editions or translation of a given author. So, directly pointed out the importance of collocation first, then the finding. And second of the contribution of Lubezki, he rightly pointed out the lacuna of the Cutter's theory and he differentiated between the concept of book and concept of work. And he argued logically that books and work are coextensive only in the case of where a work had been published but once. I do admit that in a typical library setup, 80% books actually belonging to this category, where books and work are the same thing. Most of the books are having one edition, and if a particular book has got only one edition, so there is no difference between the book and the work. But 20% of your collection, according to Lubezki, those are most frequently used books have multiple editions with different title information, variants of the author name, authorship, varying subtitle, different series title, different subsidiary authors, different editorship. So these 20% books are most frequently used in a library, and they are having multiple edition, multiple version, multiple authorship, multiple, you know, series title and different editorship. So there lies the importance of the concept or the differentiation of the concept between the book and the work. And other, you know, objectives of Lubezki, you can go on, you know, telling them. But what I particularly give importance, the contribution of Lubezki, is that his unfinished book entitled Code of Cataloging Rules actually was the basis for modern cataloging adopted by the first ICCP held in 1961. Now his another, you know, contribution is that his another book, Cataloging Rules and Principles, a critique of the ALA rules for entry and a proposed design for their revision, published in 1953, is actually formed the basis of ACR 1 in 1967. So, you know, you can see that the work of Lubezki, the concept of Lubezki, the revisions of Lubezki over the top of the theories proposed by Carter was simply revolutionary. Lubezki contrast the two ideas, work and book, bringing back into play the Antony Panizzi's original emphasis on the relationship between a title and all of the different editions of that title that might exist. Lubezki's idea was that relationship amongst all the editions and variation of a given work and the author of that work in all variations of the author's name must be established and brought together so they can be found in one place. So those were the important things proposed by Lubezki over the, you know, Carter's theory. And his book, The Cataloging in the Age of Technological Change, published in 1977, you know, one of the quotation I would like to give, provide you. He said categorically, the catalog has to tell you more than what you ask for. The answer of a good catalog is not to say yes or no, but to tell the user that the library has the item in so many edition and translation, and you can have your own choice. So that was the vision of Lubezki. And when we entered in the era of entity relationship techniques, different kind of technological advancement is happening. Now we understand what he actually proposed way back in 1977. Now, then actual formalization of bibliographic relationship was first made by Barbara Tillett. As I said, she is a rare talent, and in 1987, he actually proposed his PhD topic, doctoral dissertation, where she came up with seven taxonomic bibliographic relationship of a given bibliographic item. So this seven taxonomic relationship, what she proposed actually way back in 1987, are equivalence relationship related to copies, issues, facsimiles, photocopies, microforms and other similar reproduction; derivative relationship, variation, versions, editions, revision, translation, adaptation, paraphrases, etc. Descriptive relationship, description, criticism, evaluation or review of that work, including annotated editions, case book, commentaries, critics, etc. Whole part relationship or part whole relationship, basically a hierarchical relationship, a component part of a bibliographic item or work and its whole, including a selection from an anthology, collection or series; accompanying relationship, including supplements, concordance, indexes, catalogs, etc.; sequential relationship, successive titles in a serial, sequels of a monograph series, parts of a series, and so on. But the last one, what she proposed, shared characteristic relationship, is really interesting, and nowadays people are utilizing this shared character relationship as a common node in ER data modeling. What she proposed, that a bibliographic item and other bibliographic items what are not otherwise related but coincidentally, has a common author, common title, subject or other characteristics used as an access point. So research of Tillet actually supported the Lubeckian theory, what he proposed during the revision of Carter's code, that the first objective of the catalog should be the collocation, not the finding. So actually the research work of Barbara Tillet later on established that Lubeski was right, Carter was wrong. Now, Barbara Tillet again in 2001 came up with a beautiful, you know, modeling, where she demonstrated that our present age cataloging tools are failing to indicate bibliographic relationship beyond a cutoff point. Now, what was that particular cutoff point she proposed? She said categorically, if you look into that particular, you know, slide, that in case of equivalent relationship, in case of different edition of illustrated edition, abridged edition of a book, variation, version, slight modification, there are cataloging rules. But when there are new items or new works arised out of a particular given work, then there is actually no cataloging rules that can relate two different entities together. Something like summary, abstract, digest, dramatization, novelization, screenplay, parody, adaptation, review, casebook, criticism, evaluation. These are actually not supported by any cataloging rules in the existing codes like AACR2. So let me give you one example. Suppose there is a book written by Premchand Munshi, Godan, and there is a book, a critical analysis of Godan, written by Premchand Munshi. So these two, no cataloging rules actually there to relate these two related items. Actually these two are related items, but as it is a new work and new manifestation, there are no cataloging rules. So she directly pointed out this lacuna, these problems with the cataloging rules, in describing bibliographic relationship of different kinds. And then came the era of content designator. So up to when Barbara Tillet proposed different types of bibliographical relationship, different kind of problems related with the cataloging codes in encoding bibliographic relationship, in differentiating different kind of or in identifying different kind of bibliographic relationships, so then the ILS era started. So the entire library system, libraries of any type or any size globally started moving towards the computerized cataloging. So in case of computerized cataloging, it is all based on content designators. So three popular content designators of that time was Unimark and Mark 21, and let us see that what are the conditions of bibliographical relationship in Unimark and Mark 21. So in case of Mark 21, you see Unimark actually, first I am targeting Unimark. So Unimark identified three categories of relationships inside the content designation scheme. One is the vertical relationship, second is the horizontal relationship, and third one is the chronological relationship. So vertical relationship actually represent different kind of hierarchical relationship, whole part, part whole. Horizontal relationship between the different versions of an entity or a work. And chronological is basically establishing the relationship in time between issues of an item. For example, sequel part of a monographic series, or successive issues of a serials, etc. Now, if we as Unimark is not quite popular in this part of the world, we all use Mark 21 as the de facto global standard. So let us see what is happening in the Mark 21. So Mark 21, again you can identify it. This paper actually written in 2013, actually published in 2013 by P. Riva, where he actually demonstrated that kind of relationship, what are the relationship what are available inside Unimark, that are also available conceptually inside Mark 21. If you concentrate on the left hand side of the this particular slide, you can see that the chronological relationship is supported by the Mark 21 through the tag 777, 780 and 785. horizontal relationship is also supported by Mach 21 through different 7XX fields like 765, 767, 775, 776 and so on. And the vertical relationship, just like UNIMAC, the you know, it is also supported by the tags 760, 762, 770, 772, 773 and 774. So you can consult this particular paper. It's a good paper where actually he compared again the manifestation to manifestation relationship and mapped actually the Aperbier relationship, Mach 21 tags and Tillet taxonomy. For example, in case of Aperbier relationship, they propose reproduction on the basis of the Tillet's work. So that is supported by the tag 776 in Mach 21, and that is known by actual Tillet's taxonomy as equivalence relationship. So this way he actually mapped different kind of Aperbier relationship model, Tillet taxonomy, 7 taxonomic relationship, and how it, this can be mapped with the Mach 21 tags. So it was a great work for you know computerized cataloging activities. Now, after that content designator, the most popular things you know in information organization in the digital domain is Dublin Core metadata element sets. So, if you go through the Dublin Core metadata element sets, so there are also 6 pairs of bidirectional relationship. Is part of has part, is version of has version. Say X is version of Y. So, you can again bidirect Y has version X. X is format of Y, Y has format X. X references is referenced by, is based on, is basis for, requires, is required by. So these 6 pairs of bidirectional relationship proposed by the DCMES model, which become very popular, the generic metadata schema for the digital library system, but bibliographic relationship also exists there. Now we will jump into the technological side of this particular presentation, but again let me clear confusion that how you know bibliographic relationship or bibliographic entities actually linked with each other through different kind of you know tools or devices. So Barbara Tillet, apart from our work related to the identification of 7 taxonomic relationship, bibliographic relationship, she also identified different kind of linking devices. Say for example, if you want to establish equivalent relationship, you have dash entry as a device, notes as a device, uniform title as a device. If you want to establish derivative relationship, you can utilize references, dash entries, cost references, subject heading, common main entries, filing titles, added entries and so on. So these are all devices she proposed against each and every relationship she actually proposed in her doctoral dissertation. But most of these things you already know, main entry, uniform title, added entry, but many of our youngsters of library information science, the students, they do not have idea what is a dash entry. Let me show you an example of a dash entry. So this is a dash entry. Suppose a book has got 2 copies. Now when we are basically relating copy 2 with the you know main entities of that particular book, so we prepare a dash, we give a dash at the end of the catalog, give copy 2 detached, and this is the I reproduce from the ALA rules of 1941. So that is the concept of the you know dash entry. Rest of the things like references, series statement, all are actually working as a linking devices to establish different kind of bibliographic relationship. You all know that. So let us move on. The next important work in the domain of bibliographic relationship came from another great research worker of our time in the year 1994, that is Smiraglia. Smiraglia actually worked on a particular type of you know taxonomic relationship identified by Barbara Tillet, the derivative relationship. So Smiraglia found through her research work, a series of research paper he produced, that there are different kind of derivations, derivative you know work, simultaneous derivations, successive derivations, translation may be considered as a derivation, amplification, extraction, adaptations and performance. So Smira Gill actually added more categories and subcategories in addition to the 7 fundamental taxonomic relationships proposed by Barbara Tillet. Then the next important work has done by S. L. Velucci in the year 1997. Although Velucci primarily worked in the music metadata system or music cataloging system, but at the end of her research related to applications of bibliographic relationship in the music domain, in music cataloging, she proposed at the end of her research 4 fundamental bibliographic principles related to bibliographic relationship. First principle is the principles of relationship identification. Second one is the principles of enabling linkage. Third one is the principles of multi-level description. And the fourth one is the principle of consistency. So, IFLA working committee, by that particular time, you already know that FRBR first published in 1998. So, IFLA was all ready to develop or publish their FRBR. They immediately took the principle as proposed by the Velucci and incorporated as it is basis in the principles part of FRBR model. So, that was the importance of the work of Velucci. She actually established the proposition as done by Barbara Tillet. Now, when in 1998, I am going through a chronological development of bibliographic relationship, FRBR first implemented EAD data modeling. So far, we never thought of the application of EAD data modeling to take the full advantage of the backend relational database management system. So, FRBR first came with the 3 groups of entity, you all know. Now, here I have shown you only the first group of entities: work, expression, manifestation and item. And FRBR actually proposed different kind of bibliographical relationship. Work actually is realized through expression. Similarly, work is related to expression through, is realized through relationship. Similarly, expression is related to work through the relationship realizes. So, work is, you can see in this way. So, work is related to expression through, is realized through relationship. Similarly, it is a bidirectional relationship. One work may have many expressions. So, expression realizes work. Similarly, expression is embodied in manifestation. So, manifestation embodies expression. So, one expression may have many manifestation. Similarly, manifestation is exemplified by an item. Similarly, one manifestation may have many items, an item is related to a particular manifestation through exemplifies relationship. So, that kind of EAD data modeling first done by FRBR, and till date it holds quite true, and many of the library technologies like integrated library system, LSP, digital library system are actually taking advantage of the relationship proposed through FRBR model. Now, the question comes to your mind that is FRBR is really a new one, that is IFLA first proposed that one and it is a completely new from the work of the doyen of library cataloging right from the time of Paniji through Carter, Lubezki, Barbara Tillet and so on. Now, let me show you that FRBR is not completely a new one. The inherent concept there inside our library catalog, FRBR is perfectly identified that particular theory behind the practice. So, we practiced that, but we did not have a theoretical basis. The same way we established DDC or library classification way back in 1876, but the first dynamic theory of classification proposed by S. R. Ranganathan in the year of 1957, the same thing happened actually. Practice first, then FRBR came with a theory. So, let me give one example. Let us consider drama written by Shakespeare, you all know the Hamlet. Now, I am taking the record related to Hamlet from Library of Congress, because most of you actually are well acquainted with the catalog of Library of Congress. So now here you see the main entry, Shakespeare William, Hamlet in French. So Shakespeare William is a person, Hamlet is a work, you can see here. So concept was there. Now in the next slide you can see that French is an expression, because Hamlet available in as a French translation. So French is an expression. Now if you go to the next part of the cataloging, this personal name, main title, publication and distribution area, physical description area, all related to the manifestation. And if you come down to the latter part of the, or the bottom part of the catalog, this is actually related to the item. So concept of work, expression, manifestation and item, all are inherently or hidden there inside a card catalog. First paper we have proposed that model, that this is the theoretical backdrop, and on the basis of that theoretical backdrop actually we work. So as I said that FRBR proposed group 1 entities, we demonstrated. So there are other entities, group 2 entities and group 3 entities. So these are the relationship for group 2 entities, created by, realized by, produced by, owned by and so on. Then the group 3 is actually related to different kind of object, event, subject and place. So has a subject relationship serves the basis for identifying the subject of an individual work and ensures that all relevant works to a given subject are linked to that particular subject. Now after that FRBR happened, as I said that in 2016 IFLA actually combined all the related bibliographic data models like FRBR, FRAT and FRACD into a single set, which is called LRM, Library Reference Model. And LRM and BibFrame 2.0 are competing with each other. So let us, in this particular section, let us take a look that which model is a better one and which we need to follow in the future of our cataloging activities. So in the slide you can see now that this is the model of BibFrame. They have given 3 levels, work, you can remember that if FRBR gave 4 levels, work, expression, manifestation and item. In place of that, they have given us 3 levels, work, instance and item. And there are different kind of bibliographical relationship, how work is related to an agent. Agent is basically a person. He can be a personal author or a corporate author, and a producer, printer and so on. So this kind of this what I consider, that is my personal view of course, that BibFrame 2.0 is a poor imitation of FRBR. What I am saying, so now suppose you again imagine a particular work, the essential Homer, available in 2 versions. One is the English text, another is the sound recording of that particular text. So if you see the FRBR part of this particular slide, FRBR can rightly identify that the essential Homer is a work, and essential Homer in English text is an expression of that particular work, and essential Homer as sound recording is another expression of that particular work. So here we are maintaining both the progenitor relationship as well as bibliographic relationship. We can easily identify the hierarchical relationship between the work and expression, and the way these two expressions are related to each other. Now when you come down to BibFrame actually never thought about the work per se. They have given the name work, but they are simply talking about the expression. The same thing, if we catalog on the basis of the BibFrame 2.0 model, we need to have 2 different entities. One is the essential Homer English as work, another was the essential Homer sound recording as another work. So what is happening here, both the progenitor relationship as well as bibliographic relationship are lost. So in my view, as a little bit of with little bit of technological knowledge and relation and data modeling knowledge, that BibFrame 2.0 is going to fail in certain point of time, and the model proposed by FRBR and consolidated in LRM will be existing one to follow. So you can read the documents and can prepare your own opinion. Don't go by my opinion, but that is my personal opinion that BibFrame is going to fail because of this kind of relationship. It is losing one of the most important components as proposed by RDA. RDA proposed that entities and relationships are entities, attributes and relationships are two most important things in the bibliographic universe, and the bibliographic relationship part is actually lost in BibFrame. Now, is there any practical application related to, is there any practical application related to this kind of, bibliographic relationship? In fact, again, the leader of our field, OCLC, came up with number of, initiatives. The XISBN I have written here, but XISBN is now a deprecated service. It is not available now from the last six months. So, but still I have included XISBN just to tell you that that was the service also actually provided to relate a different kind of, bibliographic relationship. So, first and the foremost one of OCLC initiative is the fiction finder, second is the algorithm. These are all projects. Extending the case of Clinker, case study, the effervarization of Humphrey Clinker and work records in WorldCat. So, let me tell you or let me show you the WorldCat fiction finder, how they are actually proposing or visualizing bibliographic relationship. So, the web address or the URL I have given in the bottom part of this particular slide. Now, in that fiction finder, I searched by a very famous novel, that is Root, one of again my favorite novel. So, here you see the author is Alex Haley. And there are 222 editions, and you can remember the proposition made by Lubezki way back in 1977, that he told us categorically that the most frequently used works in a typical library of any type of size, must be having multiple edition, multiple editorship, multiple translation. So, it is happening, you see, in case of WorldCat Fiction Fighter. The moment I search by Root, it actually retrieved there are 222 editions of Root in 7 languages held by 9160 libraries. Now, if I click further to see that these 222 editions, now you can see that all editions of the famous book or famous novel Roots are actually categorized by OCLC depending on different factors, not only chronological factors but different other factors. So, here you can see in the first case most of these are available in printed formats. But if you go by the 222 entries are there, if you go to the last part of this fiction finder entries, we will be seeing that most of the modern entries or editions related to the Root is basically ebooks and already clubbed together jointly in fiction finder by OCLC. Now, is it possible to reflect that kind of deduplication, that kind of merging of different editions under a single work in a library catalog? Okay, let me tell you another tool, that is the Trove. You all know the it is one of the best digital library of our time, developed by National Library of Australia. Now, there I searched by a book called Managing Metadata in Web Scale Discovery System, edited by another great thinker of our time, Louis Spiteri. So, there are two editions of the book, and you see here, so two different works they have not produced. They produced a single work, Managing Metadata, available in two different versions, and this is the edition 1 and this is the edition 2. So, how they actually grouped visually both the editions related to the same work in a library catalog. So, that kind of advancement is happening in library catalog. Now, with all these initiatives, started on the basis of LRMN and BibFrame, through OCLC, through Trove, again took a sharp turn with the introduction of RDA, resource description and access. And as I said, that RDA categorically told us that in the bibliographic universe, it is only trinity, entities, the relationships and attributes of an entity. So, relationships are a principle that governs RDA and one of the two kinds of elements. So, entities and relationships are two kind of elements, primary elements as proposed by RDA. That is the importance of bibliographic relationship as established in the work of RDA and as proposed by Lubezki way back in the decade of 70s. But there are some serious observations what I made with that is available with the RDA. So, RDA, you know, it is available free of cost for everybody for 1 month. You can register yourself to the beta toolkit of RDA free of cost. They will provide you, 1 month of, access, full access. So, what I do normally, I change my email ID and I go on, subscribing RDA, they never bother. So, that way you can also access RDA beta toolkit. I do it for my students. So, relationship is a very important principle and entity or component of RDA, but until recently those are basically appendices I through M, not chapters. In beta toolkit there are three levels. So RDA first treated relationship through different appendices, appendix I through appendix M. Then the beta toolkit came, so relationship, they changed the nomenclature relationship to relationship elements, and again the beta toolkit provided recently a relationship matrix. So, this is the relationship matrix, different, you can go on to the RDA beta toolkit set, you can opt for relational relationship matrix, but that is I'll be coming that this particular facility is not there. What happened I will be telling you, but relational relationship matrix they proposed as the a second version of bibliographic relationship. You can select an entity, group one entity like work, manifestation, item or expression. Then if you select that particular entity, under that entity lot many bibliographical relationships will be established. For example, here you see how a particular work is related to other related work. So, that means different kind of relationship can be possible, abridged as work, abridgment of work. So, you see these are all bidirectional, absorbed by work, absorbed in part by work, absorption in part of work, absorption of work. So, this kind of work to work relationship is available. If you want to relate to work to expression, what are different kind of relationship matrix are there? Analysis of expression, analyzed in expression. So, this kind of bidirectional relationships is there, but that created lot many problems, because you see it is not quite easy for a cataloger to utilize this kind of different kind of work to work, work to expression, work to manifestation, manifestation to item. This is becoming very complex for a cataloger. So, recently in July 2020 they proposed a much more efficient format of relationship. Here you see I have selected the entity manifestation, and this is the all elements or attributes related to manifestation. If I click, attributes will be coming. If I click the relationship matrix here, all relationships related to a particular manifestation will be coming. If I click here manifestation to item, so this will be here I have selected manifestation to manifestation, so these are the bibliographic relationship. If I select manifestation to item, there will be a different sets of bibliographic relationship. So this is much more logical approach, and I am quite happy now to deal with different kind of bibliographic relationship as proposed by RDA beta toolkit. You can all check it, because as I said that it's completely free for 1 month, and you can go on or carry on through changing your email ID. Another important after the RDA, another important initiative took place, that is called CCO, cataloging cultural object. As I said you that libraries are not alone in the bibliographic universe anymore. So all the theories, all the codes, all the models need to take into consideration the glam world, galleries, libraries, archives and museum. So this is the bibliographical model proposed by CCO. It's a slightly complex in nature, and it must be. But one interesting thing they proposed, that is the visualization of bibliographical relationships. So the idea of visualization of bibliographic relationships actually I got from this particular CCO model. It's a very complex to follow, but some of the fundamental concepts they proposed are simply superb. So let me tell you that how CCO can help us in identifying and visualizing bibliographic relationship. Say for example, This is one of my most favorite public library, Birbhum District Library. In fact, my entire childhood I spent in Birbhum District Library. So I have taken the example of Birbhum District Library. So suppose one particular item, let us say Harry Potter, one of the Harry Potter book available in Birbhum District Library. So that particular item has got an identifier and has got a location. That location is Birbhum District Library. Identifier may be the accession number of the book or ISBN number of the book. Now, item is actually part of the manifestation. You all know because of the FRBR model. So manifestation has following attributes: title proper, Harry Potter, identifier, ISBN, author J.K. Rowling, then the cover page illustration. So this is the cover page illustration, illustration drawn by Mary Gant Prey. This is the first Indian edition, and so on and so forth. So these are all, you know, attributes related to the manifestation of the book, Harry Potter, one of the Harry Potter book. Now, how this manifestation is related to the, expression and work. So in the next slide, you can see that manifestation has got as a part of the expression or as a, you know, realization of an expression. So expression has following attributes: Library of Congress call number, language of expression is a very important feature or attribute, content type, intended audience. Then expression is again related to work, bidirectional relationship. So expression realizes work. Or work is realized through expression. So work level, there are many attributes: identifier of the work, preferred title of the work or uniform title in some cases. For example, if you are cataloging the Gita, then, or Mahabharata, or any kind of epics, then you see the preferred title or uniform title will come into picture. Then work is has got an author, then author is a person, name of the author, and many other, you know, relationships or entities, attributes related with that particular entity is called author, which is basically a group two entity of FRBR. So this is a complex scenario, as you can see, but we are all practicing this, but we are not visualizing this. That is the problem. Now, all these bibliographical relationships can be visualized in which way? But before, going into the visualization of all these bibliographic relationships, so far I discussed the theoretical backdrop of bibliographic relationship right from the time of Antony Panizzi Venonius to Barbara Tillett. So last 200 years of theoretical development happened on the top of bibliographic relationship that we discussed, that we explained. But there is nothing more practical than a good theory. Once Scott Lewin proposed that particular quote, and it's a very famous or favorite quote of mine: nothing is more practical than a good theory. So if bibliographical relationship theory as proposed by Barbara Tillett, as modified by Smiri Gila, as fine tuned by S.L. Bellucci, if this is a, it has got a solid theoretical foundation, then there is no point that we cannot produce the same theory at the practical level. So we are doing that particular things through different kind of linking devices in the domain of printed catalog, but how we can do that particular thing in a computerized cataloging setup through these different kind of visualization techniques. So here you see my next work, or the prototype work, what I am going to demonstrate before you. Actually, it is based on another paper of Barbara Tillett. She wrote actually this paper at the age of 73. Can you imagine that kind of sharp brain at this age? So Moore R.J. and Barbara Tillett published a paper in 2011. The title is very interesting: Cataloging Theory in Search of Graph Theory and Other Ivory Towers, published in the journal, famous journal, Information Technology and Libraries, volume 30, issue number 4. So that paper is actually based on the mathematical model given by Ellure way back in 1736. So So Ellul proposed a mathematical model which is called the graph theory, and his famous problem, mathematical problem, that is known as seven bridges of Königsberg problem. He first published that particular mathematical problem, that particular mathematical theory, which is called graph theory, way back in 1736. So that graph theory technology applied by Murray Archer, and they proposed a solid theoretical model for visualizing bibliographic relationship. So before entering into the details of that particular theory or the essence of the theory given by Murray and Tillett, let me tell you something about the graph theory. But please remember that I am not from the domain of mathematics, so I may not be able to explain the complexities of graph theory, but I am trying to tell you in a non-technical way so that you can understand it, the application of graph theory in network domain, in cataloging domain. So as I said that Ellul first proposed the seven bridges of Königsberg mathematical problem. The problem was that a city has got seven bridges, and you need to walk all seven bridges without crossing a bridge twice. So that was the problem. So he gave a solid mathematical theory to solve that particular problem, and later on this graph theory nowadays people are utilizing in many context, in artificial intelligence, in machine language, in deep learning, in network theory, and many more. So let me tell you a very simple problem to make you understand this graph theory. Just imagine in the left hand corner there are three cottages, and they are not good neighbors, they do not share good relationship with each other, and this every cottage needs three fundamental services. One is the fire, one is the electricity, another is the gas. Now these three companies are also not in good relationships. So what does it mean? That you cannot pass a one particular connection from one cottage to another cottage, from this cottage to this cottage, or this companies cannot share a common node for distribution of the connection. So this is the problem. If you go to the upper part of the slide, suppose there are three cottages on a plane or sphere, and each cottage needs to be connected to the water, gas, and electricity companies. Without using a third dimension, that is the common point, or sending any of the connection through another company or cottage, that I mean that no cottage can no connection can pass through any of these cottages, and no company can cross connect. So is there a way to make all nine connection, because there will be nine connection, three service provider, three cottages. So is there a way to make all nine connection without any of the lines crossing each other? So mathematically it is very difficult to solve, but if you apply the graph theory, it is actually telling you that at least one connection need to be crossed with each other. So this is not possible, this is not a solvable problem given by the mathematical condition. So in this nine relationships or nine connections, at least one connection need to cross each other. So that is the concept of graph theory, visualization of the problem, visually solve the problem, deep rooted mathematical problem. But can it be applicable to cataloging, which is basically a textual domain? Okay. If you go through the next slide, you see here it is quite possible. Let me explain. Say for example, we all know now that there are four entities under the group one: work, expression, manifestation, and item. Each of these has got their own attributes. So this is the work of a particular novel. So these are the different attributes of that work, these are the different attributes of the expression, these are the different attributes of manifestation and attributes of item. Now if we consider a common node called C, then all these labels, work, expression, and manifestation, can be linked with the common node C. C contains work, work is related to expression through different kind of, is a realization of, realized through. Then C contains expression, common note. It is related to manifestation, is an embodiment of, is embodied in. So these are all bidirectional relationship. C contains manifestation. Manifestation is also related bidirectionally to the item. So this model actually proposed by Murray and Barbara Tillett in their paper. Now I took that particular paper as the theoretical model and tried to, they never thought of any practical explanation, it's a purely theoretical paper. But as I said you that my famous quotation is that there is nothing more practical than a good theory. If the theory is good, it can be applied. So am I started talking theories again? No, not at all. Let me go through that. It is quite possible through the open source software available with us. So what we took, these are the graph theory supporting JavaScripting called cytoscape.js. It is downloadable from GitHub. Then there is another one through which you can zoom in, zoom out, or display the bibliographical relationship, because my major purpose is to visualize bibliographic relationship through cytoscape.panzoom. And there is another programs we are using, script Dagri, directed acyclic graph. And we are using Avant common plugin in the software called Omeka. So let us try to apply Dublin Core 6 pairs of bidirectional relationship and the bibliographic relationship as proposed by Eferbia. Now if you can see this particular screen, so this is our prototype bibliographical relationship. Here you can see this is an object, you all know this particular object, famous novel Titas Ekti Nodin Nam, written by Adwaita Mallavarman. But many of you know that the Titas Ekti Nodin Nam, the cover page actually illustrated by another famous artist Ronen Ayan Dotto. And how these different kind of cultural objects are related to each other. So we made a prototype of this kind of cultural text. So I'm showing you just Titas Ekti Nodin Nam. So you can see these are the different metadata element related to based on Dublin Core, qualified Dublin Core, and related to the object Titas Ekti Nodin Nam. So this is the full text resources available, and these are the related resources available. So this is the picture of the author Adwaita Mallavarman. This is the picture of the illustrator Ronen Ayan Dotto, and this is the cover page image illustrated by Ronen Ayan Dotto. So you see here there are many related items, image of the author, image, the cover page image, then the illustrator. How we can visualize, how we can help navigational approach of this complex information scenario. Now you see here, apart from retrieving or browsing this kind of resources, I have also given, or we were actually able to produce bibliographical relationship as a navigational aid on the basis of the theory as proposed by Barbara Tillett and R.J. Murray. Now you see, apart from this straightforward bibliographical elements, if my user click this relationship button here, so it will be displaying in a light box. So there I talked about that Panzoom is working. So here you see this is the object, and this object is related to two items and also related to Ronen Ayan Dotto as a reference. Now if my user click this one to visualize the node, so it will be displayed that this is the object main reference, it is the cover page image Titas Ekti Nodin Nam Prochor, and he is the writer. If my user click this one, so details about the Adwaita Mallavarman will be coming. If they click this one, details about the cover page image will be coming. So let me click the cover page. If I click the cover page, my system will again retrieve this particular cultural object. These are actually two metadata sets are combined together, the bibliographic resources cataloged by following qualified Dublin Core, and images and cultural objects are actually processed through VRA Core metadata element sets. Now here you see this particular cover page, this kind of relationship it established. If my user want to see in the larger scale in a light box, so this is the relationship. So Tita Shakti Nodin Nam is basically a cover page image of the main reference of this novel Tita Shakti Nodin Nam. This particular cover page is illustrated by Ranenayan Dotto, and this is the authored by Adwaita Vallabharvan. Now if I want to retrieve that, what are the other illustration done by Ranenayan Dotto, so if I click that, you see what happens, really different, you know, these resources are not related actually, these are all different relations, you know, entities, but because of the bibliographic relationship we can club this together. So if I click again, now you can see that this is the cover page image illustrated by Ranenayan Dotto. Ranenayan Dotto actually illustrated many more, picture, many more painting. So before coming of Mokbul Fida Hussain, Ranenayan Dotto was quite famous for his art related to horses, and any of this now you can click to have an idea. So this kind of complex bibliographic, you know, panoramic view of bibliographic relationship related to different, you know, facets, different entities, it's quite possible. That's why I always said and always tried, for the last 10 years we are trying this particular bibliographical relationship, and now it is quite possible to establish a prototype on the basis of the theoretical aspects given by R.J. Moore and Barbara Tillett. And we tested with around 500 such documents. Because of the time limitation, I cannot go through the other resources available in my prototype. But I do understand, or I do hope that you all got the idea, and you can navigate how you can navigate from one relation to another relationship, and how your users can discover different kind of they can discover the bibliographic universe on the basis of bibliographic relationship. So that's all today. See you again in some future time. So during you all please be safe and do well. Thank you very much.